Hello and welcome to the third programme in the series, The Fairy Shoe. My name is Caroline Brennan. This is a story of one tiny little shoe that was found in the Cork and Kerry Mountains back in 1836. But let me tell you, this was, or indeed is, no ordinary shoe. It's a fairy shoe. And for those sceptics of you listening and expecting a tale of folklore and fairy tale, widen that mind of yours. Because you see, this little fairy shoe exists in all its tiny glory and resides in Munster. In the last two programmes, you heard about how this tiny fairy shoe came to be in the possession of Edith Somerville, of Somerville and Ross fame and the Irish RM, and her sister Hildegard. Upon their fundraising tour of America, the women introduced this little shoe to the high society and became the toast of Boston and New York City. Back home, it helped fundraise for the district nurse employed by the Castlehaven Nursing Association in a small area of West Cork. It's been a busy little shoe. But I'm sure you're wondering, is that an utter figment of my imagination? Or does this fairy shoe really exist? Well, it does, but don't take my word for it. For a historical description of how Edith Somerville described the little fairy shoe, the fullest description I could find is in her book The States Through Irish Eyes. Let's hear how she described this tiny little shoe.
It is made of black, or what once may have been black, leather as fine and nearly as thin as silk, and yet it is real leather. That looks like the strong leather of which our countrymen's brogues are made, were it seen through a diminishing glass. It is shaped like a brogue, but is unnaturally narrow for its length. The sole at its widest is no more than 3/4 inch wide, while it is still 2 3/4 inches long. How slim and slender must be the fairy feet. There are holes in the uppers for laces. The workmanship is incredibly fine. There are signs of wear at the heel, which is wrinkled a little, and the sole is dented, no doubt with the rocks of the mountains, where its wearer fleeted the time away as in the golden age.
Isn't it wonderful to consider a little fairy fleeting the time away amongst the rocky outcrops in the mountains? Well, that is Edith Somerville's description of the fairy shoe that was written back in 1930. But what about descriptions of the shoe from people who have seen it recently? Now, as you know from the previous two programmes, Edith's sister Hildegard was the custodian of the shoe for most of her life. Here's her granddaughter, Faith Garson, giving her account of the little fairy shoe.
It's a very small little leather shoe, very narrow, too small for any normal child. It's incomprehensible how it was ever used and worn, but there's obvious signs of having been trodden with. I don't think even putting it on a doll would have produced the same care and worn effect that it has.
Now here's Tom Somerville, great-grandnephew to Edith and Hildegard, and who is the current custodian of the shoe.
It's something under 3 inches long, and at its widest point is about 3/4 inch. If you scaled it up, it would not fit a human foot. It's much too long for its width. The interesting thing about it is the heel and the back of the shoe appears to be worn in much the same way as a human foot wears a shoe. It's made of the finest leather, no laces in it, and it's got remarkably fine stitching. When you put it in your hand, it has a sort of miraculous effect on it. You look at it, and what in cold print seems strange and fantastical, once you hold it, you start to get converted and think the thing is genuine.
And finally, George Salter Townsend's own account of the shoe?
Well, many, many times as a child I held the fairy shoe in my hand. And it's alleged that, closely examined, that nobody could have done the stitching so fine. It's allegedly made of mouse skin. and all the stitching and work on it at that time could not have been done at that time, so it is claimed. You know, you could probably fake anything today with you know, modern technology. But at the time, incredible.
And incredible it is. But George has hit on something there when he said that it is alleged that the shoe was made of mouse skin. Now, wouldn't that be absolutely fantastic to consider that the leather was made from the skin of a mouse? George is not the first to hear about that particular element of the shoe. Have a listen to this piece of music. And yes, I know it's not new to you because I have been playing it throughout the series. But have a listen and I'll explain its significance in just a few moments. Sample of a jig that was written by Ireland's famous fiddle player Nollaig Casey. So what's the connection? Well, Nollaig called that jig the mouse skin shoe. And let me tell you, that is the same shoe we're talking about, only that somewhere along the way, the name of the shoe has changed from the fairy shoe to the mouse skin shoe. Well, I suppose when you hear that the shoe is possibly made out of mouse skin, suddenly you're drawn into something so much more magical. You feel wonderment. Well, I do anyway. So the obvious question to ask is this shoe made out of the skins of mice? Needless to say, to find out that the fairy shoe was made of mouse skin would have been an absolute revelation to both Hildegard and Edith. And not only that, but to have it analysed and confirmed by prestigious people such as President Angel of Yale University and his esteemed colleagues, well, that would have made headline news back in 1929. But now I'm going to put a bit of a spanner in the works. I actually do not believe that any microscopic analysing and identification happened at that dinner party on Monday the 22nd of April 1929. What did happen is explained by Edith in her account of the evening in her book The States Through Irish Eyes. So let's hear what she had to say in regards to what happened that evening.
Five, it may have been six, men of learning, occupants of those seats of the might, the chairs of the university, placed themselves round a table in the centre of which sat the little shoe in solitary state, complacently challenging investigation. Not even the professor, whose special subject was the fancies and follies of folklore, could suggest a solution that conformed with the facts. Wisdom has sometimes the courage to admit itself baffled.
So, no mention of a microscope there. Indeed, no mention of even the type of leather that the shoe was made of. I honestly cannot think of any reason why Edith Somerville would not have included such a significant revelation as a finding that the shoe was made of mouse skin in her book. And even if she was fearful of being inundated with interested parties and decided to omit that major detail from her book, there is absolutely no reason as to why she would not include it in her personal diary entry, which she so religiously kept from day to day. Anyway, the story that is the fairy shoe, or the mouse skin shoe, whichever way you want to see it, has been kept alive through verbal accounts, some limited written accounts, and of course, through the music of Miss Nollaig Casey. Let's hear another piece of that jig in celebration of one tiny shoe. Thank you. fact, there has been many variations to the stories associated with the fairy shoe. Some accounts suggest it was found around the Ahleys, or near Castletown Bear, or some have even been more general by saying it was located in the Cork and Kerry Mountains. Now, we know for a fact that the shoe was found in 1836 by a man who has been named as Patrick Lahiff, but who quickly passed it on to a doctor by the name of Armstrong. He in turn passed it on to, depending where you read, either his daughter, his cousin, or to his sister. And by the way, he did give it to his sister Ellen Armstrong. Furthermore, the facts are that the shoe did travel with Hildegard when she accompanied her sister Edith to the United States back in 1929. But again, depending on where you read, you will be told it was presented at Harvard University, not, Princeton University, not, or to Yale, which it was. Now let me tell you, sifting through documented fiction in order to find the facts is the bane of any researcher's life. So I've had to rely on extensive searches of manuscripts, diaries, published books, and from word of mouth from family members in order to put this series together. But considering the vast variation of fictional details about the shoe, it got me wondering about how much information the local people of West Cork had about the little fairy shoe. So I decided to speak to the older generation of this county, to those who recall what life was like without the electric bulb, without the flushing toilet, and from whom I thought pishogri had been part and parcel of growing up. So where better to chat to those elder historians of West Cork than in the day hospital in Skibbereen? Here's what they had to say.
Mary O'Brien, I'm over 80.
Are you from around here?
Lachine, out in Lachine.
Mary, did you ever hear of the fairy shoe?
I didn't, actually.
Mary Hennessy.
And Mary, what age are you?
72.
Did you ever hear of the fairy shoe?
No.
Peggy Beamish. I'm 85.
And whereabouts are you from?
I suppose 9 miles or 10, towards Drina direction.
And did you ever hear of the fairy shoe?
I heard of them, that's all. Thank God I never said anything.
Now, what's your name?
Sheila Sullivan,
is
yeah,
it?
Yeah.
And Sheila, what age are you?
70.
Are you from around here as well?
No, Baltimore or no, but Skibbereen.
Sheila, I'm just wondering then, did you ever hear of the fairy shoe?
No, I didn't know.
Never heard of it?
No.
What's your name?
Mick Holland.
Mick Holland, and what age are you, Mick?
86.
You're from around here, are you?
Yeah, I'm here. About 6 miles from here. Like.
Now, Mick, did you ever hear of the fairy shoe?
I heard tell of it, all right, but that's all. I never inquired about it.
Right.
You wouldn't want to have a bit to do with it.
Christina Wilson.
What age are you, Christina?
80.
Did you ever hear of the fairy shoe at all?
No.
What's your name?
Mary O'Brien.
Mary, how are you, Mary? Mary, can I ask you what age you are?
I was born on the 4th of February 1931, 78 years gone last February.
Did you ever hear of the fairy shoe at all?
No, I never heard of the fairy shoe.
I'm May McCarthy.
May McCarthy. And May, can I ask you what age you are?
I'm 74.
24.
74. Oh, bless. I wish it was.
24.
I wish it was again. 74. I grew up in Newcastle, London. Born on my left side of it.
And, Meg, did you ever hear of the fairy shoe?
I did. She's up at the Shan House in Newcastle, London.
Have you seen it, Meg?
No, I haven't. I haven't ever gone.
Have you any idea as to where it was found?
I think it was found somewhere on Quirkill. Or somewhere on those lins that were somewhere.
And just tell me where Quirkill is.
Quirkill is beyond Ventry somewhere. By some soldiers or someone I was told long ago. But I don't know where I got that story.
Sheila Regan.
And Sheila, what age are you?
I'll be 81 in October.
And Sheila, whereabouts are you from?
From Castlehaven.
Sheila, did you ever hear of the fairy shoe?
Well, I did. I heard my father tell me several times, but like I didn't. We were young that time, we never took any notice. Like, no.
Can
we're afraid, I suppose. The fairies, afraid of the fairies.
And what did you think the fairy shoe was all about?
I hadn't a clue, I'm sure. Just as a shoe belonged to some fairies that they found somewhere. Oh, we never bothered asking, like, we didn't.
Now, what's your name?
William McCarthy.
William McCarthy. Willie, what age are you in front of all these ladies now, the odd gentleman?
I'm almost 80, sir. I don't know. 79, say, yes.
And whereabouts are you from, Willie?
Castlehaven, too, out that place, out by the sea, yeah.
Willie, did you ever hear of the fairy shoe?
Never heard of it. Yeah. Probably wouldn't have taken a whole lot of interest in it because it'd be too, far-fetched, maybe, yeah.
So you're not a man who believes in the fairies?
Well, I get 4 years of my life chasing a fairy. Look, she's there. She's next to me.
4 years chasing a fairy? But it's not the kind you're thinking about. Paddy's wife, she is the only fairy in his life. Anyway, as you can see, there isn't much information or indeed knowledge about the existence of the fairy shoe in and around the area. But I'm not surprised about this. In fact, throughout the country of Ireland, so much of our folklore and artifacts get lost as time goes by. It's a fact of life. However, one place that works really hard at trying to document and maintain Irish folklore is the Department of Folklore in UCD. Let's hear from archivist Christóir McCartaigh, who believes that folklore is hugely important to the Irish people.
Folklore is a very important part of our cultural makeup. It tells us so much about our customs, our beliefs, our social mores, ethical, moral considerations. It encompasses entertainment. And I suppose, in the most general way, it really defines us in terms of identity, in terms of our cultural makeup. For a visitor who comes to Ireland, the first thing he wants to know is what distinguishes Irish people and society from his own. One particularly striking aspect of Irish culture is our fondness for the verbal arts, in particular storytelling. We often associate traditional music with Irish culture, yet storytelling is just as important, and in the past it was even more important. And you had what folklorists often define as active bearers of tradition. These were very outspoken, dynamic, extrovert individuals who enjoyed an audience and who were respected and identified as good storytellers who could command people's attention for an hour, 2 hours at a time, sometimes with very long, involved, multi-episodic stories. So storytellers were held in very high esteem throughout Ireland.
So storying is part and parcel of who we are. That really isn't a big surprise. In fact, I think storying is probably ingrained in our DNA at this stage. But when it comes to the likes of a fairy shoe, what is his interpretation of that from the academic's perspective?
The notion of a fairy shoe, I think, is connected with the idea of the leprechaun, or the luricon, as he was sometimes known, its various different names. That is the fairy shoemaker. And the fairy shoemaker in Irish fairy tradition was a solitary supernatural being who was always busy mending and repairing shoes. And, of course, a whole variety of stories are connected with the fairy shoemaker or leprechaun, the most common of which, of course, is that the notion that if you could creep up behind him unawares and grab hold of him, that you could extract the knowledge of where he hid his gold from him. And it's interesting, he's one of those almost comical, benign characters, a supernatural being that has lived on in Irish tradition down to the present, and of course has been carried abroad very much to the UK and Australia, and particularly the United States. So memories of them would be very, very strong.
I have searched high up and low down, believe me, for any mention of the little fairy shoe, and in particular all around West Cork. And in the process of my investigations, I came across the Irish Folklore Commission. Now, this was a commission that was established back in 1935, and it was government appointed. Its task at the time was to systematically collect and record Irish folklore, including the verbal arts and folk music, but also to give details and to document details of how we lived our lives back then, including the houses we lived in, the food we ate, the trades we were employed in, etc. So this commission was given the remit to go out and to record all this information. It employed 12 full-time people, but it also had something like 100 correspondents from the whole of the 32 counties. But there was a great idea that came from this, and that was using the schools and indeed the children in the schools, to gather some of the information. Let's hear from Christor McCarthy again.
The school system was a development instigated by the Folklore Commission, who approached the Department of Education in that year in 1935, and then also had meetings with the INTO, the Irish National Teachers Organisation. And between all three, they came up with the idea of having school children between the ages of 11 and 14, thereabouts. Remember that in those days, few people got secondary education. Therefore, they often had a seventh class in primary schools, so that pupils could often be up to 14 years of age. But their task each week, instead of writing for 1 year, instead of writing an English composition, what I did in my holidays, etc., etc., they were tasked with going out, speaking to their parents, their grandparents, neighbours, and gathering in information on particular topics to do with their own area, their home district, the storytelling, the proverbs, the songs, and so forth. So with the result, in fact, it was so successful in the first year that it was extended by the Department of Education for a further 6 months. And a huge volume of information was gathered in this way. And all of those, the jotters or copybooks used by the pupils, are now stored in the National Folklore Collection in UCD.
And I have been to the National Folklore Collection in UCD and in fact have read all those jotters from the West Cork region in search of some tiny morsel or mention of the little fairy shoe. But did I find a story referring to it? Not one jot. Christor probably at this stage of his career knows those records inside out. So, I thought, maybe I missed its mention, but what about Christor? Has he come across this little gem being mentioned by some little girl or boy in their own little handwriting in one of those jotters? Let's find out.
Well, I'm not aware. I haven't found any record of it in the school's collection, any reference to such an event. But yet it's not unusual. Extraordinary items that have been found in the past have been associated with the fairies. And remember that anything that is strikingly small, diminutive, is often associated with the fairies and indeed the fairy shoemaker, who were seen as diminutive beings. So the association quite clearly in that local district is very, very strong, and perhaps refers to an older tradition, a local legend about such a meeting between a mortal, a human, and a fairy shoemaker or fairy of some description.
But let's get back to another important question relating to this little shoe. Is it really a fairy shoe? Well, maybe you can be the judge of that. How? Well, why don't you have a look at it? The Somerville family gave permission for the shoe to be written about. A book published by Penguin entitled Demonic Realities, A Field Guide to the Underworld, was written by well-known writer Patrick Harper. But not only did he write about the shoe, but indeed, and very unusually, he got permission from the family to reproduce a black and white photograph of it for the book. So it's there for all to see. But there are some who have been fortunate to have gotten a closer inspection of it. And not only that, but have sought to authenticate the fairy shoe. One such person who was, up until very recently, the minder of the shoe is Christopher Somerville, also known as Dan Somerville to family and friends, who appears to have made efforts in that direction. In his correspondence with an American publisher of the Demonic Realities book, Tom Blachico, he wrote,
"As for the shoe, I have shown it to a cobbler, and he said the workmanship is better than he could do. The shoe is so small. I have also shown it to a fashion historian and collector of dolls, furniture, clothes, etc. She said it was definitely not a doll's shoe. She also said the shoe was in the fashion of 1820, long and narrow. It was found in the Kerry Mountains in 1834. But why should the fairies care about fashion? She showed us a black army boot of 1850, half size and made for ease of carrying by a travelling cobbler. He would use these as samples, setting them out at fairs to show customers what he could do. She could not think why our shoe was made so small. if it was such a sample.
So you see, it just does not make any sense for it to be a sample. It's just too small. But of course, the burning question is, did I ever get to see the little fairy shoe? Well, yes, I finally got to see it. And wow, was it worth it? Absolutely. Could I authenticate it? Only by using my eyes. Would I have loved to take it away and get archaeologists to assess it and assay it with a whole barrage of tests? Absolutely. But that was never going to be permitted. Am I complaining? Not in the least. Let me tell you, after all my efforts to see the shoe, to finally get permission was wonderful in itself and the ultimate reward. So there you have it, the fairy shoe. It does exist. I've seen it with my own two eyes. And no, I didn't get any tingles, or indeed extra luck, or anything untoward. But I will tell you this. It is so perfectly made and so tiny, plus the fact that it appears worn down. I'm a believer. And why not? I am Irish after all. And us Irish, we grew up listening to tales of wakes and weddings, superstitions and the Irish way of life. It's who we are. So here's my advice to you. Stay open to the unexplained. It may just bring you to wonderful, exciting places, like the places we visited in our imagination when we were small little boys and girls. This series would not have been possible without the help of so many people. First of all, to all the archivists in Queen's University, in the Department of Folklore in both UCD and UCC, thank you. And most especially to both the Townsends and the Somervilles and their extended families, without whom this series would not have been possible. You know who you are. A sincere thank you to you all. This series has been kindly supported by the Sound and Vision Scheme, which is a funding scheme from the Broadcasting Commission of Ireland.